Hello, just over a year ago, David Puttnam left his job as chairman of Columbia Pictures after 12 months there. It was the end of an extraordinary episode. Not only had an English film producer been given the chance of heading a major Hollywood studio, but Columbia's owners, Coca-Cola, had given him what amounted to complete freedom to make films on any subject and in any way he wanted. Yet in his brief stay there, Puttnam's chosen approach to the job so alienated Hollywood's old guard that it became impossible for him to survive. It seemed a major setback in an otherwise unbroken career. Putnam began in advertising in the 60s, had a start as a photographer's agent representing David Bailey and others, and moved from there to producing feature films like Midnight Express, Chariots of Fire, Local Hero, The Killing Fields, and most recently, The Mission. Today, he's undoubtedly Britain's leading film producer, seemingly undamaged by his time at Columbia. He's just announced a new £30 million package to fund films for his own company, Enigma, the kind of sum that no other European producer would be likely to raise. I talked to him a few weeks ago in the house he and his wife Patsy have bought in Wiltshire. Some months before that, when he was just coming out of the Hollywood storm, I interviewed him in the house he rented from Greta Garbo.
The truth of the matter is that sooner or later, as a filmmaker, you have to come here to Hollywood.
I mean, either to find that you do like it, in which case you embrace it, or it embraces you, or in the alternative, that you don't like it and you're determined to make your way in your own country. But when I first came here 2 years ago, I certainly have very little to complain about. I was given virtual autonomy at Columbia, and every reason to believe that the next 3 years were going to be productive, even if they weren't going to be that enjoyable. So no one ever turned up with more going for them.
As sea skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed days, dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
You'd made a very powerful base in England. So when you were offered this Columbia job, it was more than an offer of a job. It was actually a temptation to leave behind a way that you'd set yourself.
Well, I made great play and I made a lot of the fact that I was only going to take a 3-year role at Columbia. I mean, not for one moment. Patsy and I specifically agreed that it wouldn't be for more than 3 years. We discussed it with the children and everything else. Then there were two other important factors. One was, and it was very important, whatever you do in the film industry, you always wonder what it would be like to run a studio, what it would be like not to have to continually have to play the game of putting films together. And Patsy made this point over and over again, that what will happen when you're in 10 years' time, when you're 55, won't you wonder what it would have been like, or what your life would have been like, or what you would have learned had you accepted the offer from Columbia. The offer came with no strings. I didn't feel I was letting myself down in any way. I wasn't compromising.
What was the deal? What were you being offered? I'm not talking about cash, but I mean, what was the deal?
An autonomous right to run a studio, to make between 12 and 15 films a year, and to be responsible for their worldwide marketing. I mean, the financing and marketing of a large group of films. More importantly, I laid out, I think, quite specifically, and at the time it seemed to get an enthusiastic response. More importantly, the opportunity to get the studios to address the international obligations and opportunities that existed. I mean, to have a studio which wasn't just another domestic studio, but which saw itself and set itself up as a studio with a different personality, a studio with a more global view, and a studio with a more adventurous view in terms of the nature of the material that it was to make.
Would you tell us what the situation was at Columbia before you came, concentrating on how films were packaged, how what we saw on screen came to the screen, and why it came that way?
When it comes down to it, there are only really three ways to run a studio, and they're self-evident. One is that you farm your product, if you like, out to a group of producers, or they can be producer directors, and you look to, you become effectively a bank, and you look to half a dozen people, or maybe more, to supply you with one, two, three films a year. And you are the core company, if you like. Second way of doing it is what I tried to do at Columbia, which is what, to an extent, they've rather successfully done at Disney in the last couple of years, which is the studio reverts to what studios were in the 1930s and 40s, and you become, the studio itself becomes the core. The people that work at the studio become, as it were, the initiators and instigators of material, and they farm it out. So instead of being a receiver of films from other people, you initiate the material. The third way is to try and mix the two. Columbia fell very much into the first category. They had a group of some good, some less good producers supplying product into the company. And I've referred to them, some people find it offensive, I've referred to them as a group of baronies. Like they were baronies, effectively running what was to all intents and purposes a fairly weak principality. The principality merely supplying the finance and, of course, the distribution expertise.
What would be the tendency of these baronies? What characteristic do they have in common? How did they package, and what would their product be like?
Vary from baron to baron, but the overall tendency would be that they would have either strong or loose relationships with the major agencies. And the packages would comprise of probably a screenplay written by somebody who was represented by an agent, who would then initially show that screenplay to the directors that the agent represented. Nothing wrong with this. I mean, that's, I suppose, the business they're in. And the whole thing, we call it a package, the whole thing would come as a package to the producer, screenplay, director, and probably some fairly specific suggestions as to major casting. So the producer then inherited these elements and got on with the ugly job of physically putting the film together.
I can see how this can work, and you've suggested how it could work. What are the disadvantages?
The disadvantages, you don't grow any esprit or talent, really, within the studio itself. So you get into a self-perpetuating situation whereby, because the studio isn't actually responsible for the work it generates, it doesn't attract the best of the talent, and therefore, because it doesn't attract the best of the talent, it sooner or later isn't even able to be responsible for the work it generates. And so you had this cycle of weak management with relatively weak employees accepting a subsidiary role in the way of things.
When you came here, then, you found the Columbia studio. What did you find, and what did you determine to change, and specifically?
Well, I found a company infinitely more demoralised than I'd imagined possible. It was rudderless. It hadn't had a chief executive at all for 6 months, I think. It was a company that had no belief in itself. It had been through, I think, four managements in very rapid succession. And a very sad place. I mean, the corridors were silent. Everyone worked behind closed doors. It was really odd. I remember writing, I was on my own the first couple of months, I wrote home to Patsy. I remember saying that here was a creative enterprise which didn't seem either creative nor enterprising. There are a lot of things I desperately underestimated. I underestimated the kind of opposition that the sort of policies I wanted to pursue would gain from what you could term the Hollywood establishment. I also think I seriously underestimated the potency of what I felt was the creative groundswell to do better work. I mean, like you, I spend my life talking to people, writers, actors, actresses, directors, who constantly saying, you know, I would love to do better work. I just don't get the scripts, or I don't get the opportunity, or one thing or another. Now, I believe that absolutely, as a matter of fact, because I also knew it would have been my situation as a producer. What I hadn't realised was the fear factor that operates here in Hollywood, and the manner in which, whilst people will say those things privately, when it really comes to being public about it, they're under enormous pressure not, you know, to hide. And I think I walked into a pretty good straight right there. I mean, I thought that there was a constituency out there that could be addressed and encouraged.
Inside Hollywood itself?
Within Hollywood itself. Yeah. And although I think it does exist, I'm as sure today as I was the day I arrived that it existed, that it exists, I hopelessly underestimated the manner in which they were fearful of for their futures and for their present careers.
When Puttnam first arrived at Columbia, he was horrified at how few films were underway. Roxanne and La Bamba were in production, but he urgently needed to find new product. He turned to old friends, Ridley Scott's Someone to Watch Over Me, John Boorman's Hope and Glory, and Bill Forsyth's Housekeeping were all picked up from other studios. Bertolucci's The Last Emperor was also underway, and Puttnam fought hard to claim it for Columbia. But he badly needed to build up Columbia's own internal strength. The thing that interests me, I'd like to talk further about, interests me most, is how you built up the core of people who are going to become the creative cluster, if you like.
I found, to my very pleasant surprise, that the people at the studio were very good once you really started to talk to them, certainly the bulk of them. And so, interestingly, the core of, as it were, Columbia Mark II under me was very much the remainder of the company that I took over. I then tried to embellish that with people I knew and people who had specific skills that I thought were missing. That was the, as it were, the internal core. Then what I did was go out into the community and try and find what I would term the disenfranchised, the people whose work I personally admired, but who either for one reason or another are unfashionable, or whose work just hadn't clicked with the other studios. And then lastly, I put a lot of time, effort and energy into the development of programs for young producers, young directors, young writers. We actually instigated 5 programs during the time I was at the studio with good results. I mean, funnily enough, our very first young director program resulted in an Oscar nomination for the first of the movies that was made. We had a minorities program, one for women and another one for black and Hispanic minorities, because they are hopelessly underrepresented in Hollywood at present.
Were you looking for, within certain parameters, of course, were you looking for a particular sort of movie?
I suppose so. I mean, if you'd asked me this a year ago, I probably would have denied it, but I think I was, yes. I mean, I've always had this theory, I think we've discussed it before. When I'm teaching, I always talk about all movies and movies. I'm fed up with and I kind of despise the notion that a film is commercial or it's meaningful. I think that's a kind of hopeless, self-defeating notion. What I've always tried to do is come up with films which are genuinely entertaining, because I think that's an obligation, but at the same time have something to say, that address an issue, that where the audience walks out with some value in addition to it, to the straight entertainment value. And I don't see these things as in conflict at all. I am utterly convinced, as I believe you are, that cinema has a huge social role to play in our lives. Now, why do I believe that? I believe that because I know what it did to me as a young man. I know that sitting in the cinema between the ages of, I guess particularly between the ages of 12, 16, 17, my whole view of life and the world and the way in which the world might be organized was formed. My view, if you like, of morality and ethical way in which we conduct ourselves was formed at the cinema. Now, if that happened to me, then I have to assume that it's happening today and has been happening for the last, in the intervening 30 years as well. So I do think that cinema has an important role to play, and I really, really wanted to see the studio and the filmmaker in partnership fulfilling that role.
It's a tricky one, isn't it? Because the drive that, say, one strand of Hollywood films had, the domestic films that they made, the drive was all marriages are happy. All marriages are utterly, except when you did have an occasional shock horror divorce, all marriages are perfect, and so on. Now, that isn't the case, obviously. And so what was being presented in the name of an ideal was also an untruth and a distortion. So what do you do about even anything as simple as that?
All right, well, let's discuss that, because I think it's a very important issue. And I think, for me, this is where cinema and television become different mediums and complementary mediums as well. I think television's a great medium for dealing in truth, you know, real truth, reality.
You mean documentary truth?
Documentary truth. I mean, one of the reasons I find being interviewed on television is interesting is that I've never looked at an interview of myself without learning something about myself. If you try and lie to the camera, it seeks you out and finds you. I'm absolutely certain.
It's a lie detector. Yeah.
It is, and in that respect, it's a marvellous medium. Now, cinema deals in something different. Cinema takes people at their most vulnerable, and in a way, if you like, almost at their most unconscious. People look at a cinema screen, it's bigger than them, they're in darkness, it's shared experience, and they drift off. And I think they drift off in a very positive way. If at that moment you don't feed people ideals more than just ideas, or ideals, if you like, mixed with ideas, I think you're doing them a disservice. I think it's very important, Melvyn, honestly, to encourage people to believe, at least believe, that good men behaving properly and believing in truth will overcome. Because if we don't believe that, if none of us believe that, then half the people in Hollywood, for example, would still be making bricks for the pharaohs. You have to believe in the potential of the human spirit. It's all we have. It's the only thing that sees us through crises.
And that was what you were trying to turn the studio around to do.
Yes, the whole purpose of which comes back to my original conversation with Coca-Cola, was to build a studio for the years for 1995, and a staff that could take over in 1990 from me with an ethos in place. I know that's a rather overused word, but my thought was all I can do in 3 years, try and create an ethos, try and create an enthusiasm, and try and create a direction for the company, and then leave it to the people who are there to run it.
What you described is thoroughly thought through and comprehensive, and seems to be a short and long-term winning ticket. Was there a time when you thought, well, this is bowling along?
There was a period of 3, 4, 5 months where I thought we really were getting somewhere. I can't say that I was enjoying the job. I never enjoyed the job. I found it trying, frustrating, and in many respects, sort of the most uncreative period of my life. I didn't love it, but I did think we were getting somewhere, and I did think that the 3 years that I anticipated I might be there were beginning to feel as though they might be rewarding.
What feeling did you have around town? I mean, the idea is that you very early on affronted, as well as disenfranchised, the establishment. The agent package was something you weren't going to buy. You thought it was wasn't good enough, and it was too expensive anyway.
I used to hear plenty of murmurings, but I think, I don't know whether he's arrogant or what, my dad always taught me that a man is judged by not just by the caliber of his friends, but also by the ambitions of his enemies. And frankly, as I began to get the murmurings of who my enemies were, and those people who anything but wished me well, I thought, well, they're not bad enemies to have. I mean, they seemed to me a reasonable sign that what we were doing was in place, effective, and might work. You see, the principal attack, and we haven't touched on this, the principal attack I guess I was making was on people's incomes.
Sure.
I inherited a job where a great number of people were making rather more than $1 million a year out of the existence of Columbia Pictures. And the idea of halving or quartering that did not appeal to them at all. And I really was trying to make the point that we would make films based only on and solely on the quality of material. Whereas there were people who had, in the past, been having films made, not I wouldn't say only, but very largely as a result of their relationship with the studio, their core relationship with the studio. And that changed. And so I didn't make friends. On the other hand, there was no way of making friends with those people. You couldn't put in place the policy I had and retain their friendship. There's no point. I might have been able to tap dance more effectively or try and ameliorate the situation rather. But again, I come back to the central point. I'd only give myself 3 years. I really didn't have time.
Putnam's enemies were powerful. They included Mike Ovitz, an influential agent who represented, amongst others, Sylvester Stallone, veteran producer Ray Stark, and stars Dustin Hoffman and Warren Beatty, who tried to blame Putnam for the flop of their film Ishtar. Finally, Putnam alienated Bill Cosby, then riding high on a successful TV series. Bill Cosby proved to be Putnam's most dangerous critic. Not only was Cosby a major star, used to controlling his own projects, he was also Coca-Cola's $4 million a year spokesman and an investor in the company.
My predecessor had come to an arrangement, which on the face of it was a very sound one, with Bill Cosby to star in his first comedy, certainly the first comedy since he became this kind of mega television megastar in this country. What happened was that turned into a script which was anything but wonderful. And I think, in hindsight, that if in January and February of 1987, I'd really taken a tough line and said, look, I'm very sorry, much as I admire Bill Cosby, and I do as an artist, I think he's a very clever man, this is rubbish and just shouldn't be made. I probably could have battled that through, but there were real problems. Cosby, you know, owned a big slice of a Coca-Cola bottling plant in Philadelphia. He'd been the Coca-Cola spokesman on television. He was a close friend, or certainly acquaintance, with the Coca-Cola management. And at the time, I had other fish to fry and other problems to solve. In hindsight, I let that drift forward. The film got made. I did my best to bring together elements of that would make it a bit better. And of course, a pretty catastrophic film resulted from the whole thing. But worse than that, a pretty catastrophic relationship with Bill Cosby also bubbled forth. And he had a lot of clout in all of this.
What are these Coca-Cola people doing anyway, frankly? I can be rude about that. What are they knowing about movies when the fact that they play golf with Bill Cosby, who owns a bottling plant and fronts their product, has got anything at all to do with the way you want to make films?
Well, I mean, that's an interesting... What you're criticising, which is, and rightly to criticise, is my failure to grasp the deeper realities of the situation. I was looking at... It was two sides of the mirror. I was looking at the positive aspects. What did Coca-Cola bring? Unlimited capital resources, an apparent enthusiasm for a studio that was the type of studio that I certainly believed there was room for. And personally, extremely nice people. I mean, all of them there. Everyone I ever met at Coca-Cola was extremely affable and nice and fairly bright. Set against that were these, as you say, very, very strange, whimsical attitudes. At the end of the day, I think that I was living in one real world, and they lived in a different real world.
At the end of the day, brutally, do you think when they got to the 19th hole on the golf course, I'm sure, but they probably drink non-alcoholic drinks, those guys, and that sort of thing. Anyway, did they say it's Cosby or Puttnam?
It may well have come to that, but by that time it wasn't just Cosby or Puttnam. It was Cosby and probably six or seven other people and Puttnam, or Puttnam.
Was there something else? I mean, aren't you, by insisting on 3 years, weren't you giving them, you're a tough act to follow, weren't you giving them a real problem? And weren't you, in that sense, sort of not, they might say, look, if he's really serious about radically changing this studio, say, he should give us another year or two, because if he's really serious, he should see it through. Weren't you giving them a stick to beat you with?
They would say the mistake we made was, they did push very hard for 5 years. The mistake that they would probably say is that we should have absolutely insisted on 5 years, and it should have been a deal breaker. And when Puttnam said it could only be three, we should have agreed, we should have shaken hands and agreed to remain friends, and that would have been that. So maybe really what we're discussing is a total misunderstanding. Misunderstanding on my part for underestimating the enormous problems I was giving myself for being so implacable about the 3 years. Misunderstanding on their part for thinking I could be persuaded to stay longer.
Do you think it was either helpful or wise to be so bullish and articulate about A, your own objectives inside Columbia, and B, your own objections about a lot of the rest of Hollywood?
Well, there's three answers, and I don't know if you'll feel anything satisfactory. One is, and this is ego, I had a tremendous concern that I might be, someone who'd been vehemently critical of the Hollywood system, I mean, certainly for the last decade and beyond, I was very concerned that people like yourself would say, oh, look, there's old Puttnam. He gets a new job, he goes up to Hollywood, and suddenly he's changed his tune. He's no longer critical. All of a sudden, the things he found objectionable are now wonderful. So I was sort of very conscious of the fact that I wanted to remain consistent and true to myself in one way. That's an excuse, if you like. Secondly, I had this problem of trying to get across very quickly to what I saw as the artistic community, or the creative community in Hollywood, a theory, a vision, if you like, of a different type of studio. And I wanted to appeal to them over the head, if you like, of their agents, because I couldn't absolutely rely on the fact that on a one-to-one basis with the agents or even the artists themselves, that message would get across. It was very important for me to publicly leap that barrier. Thirdly, comes back to the three-year business, that I didn't have long enough to persuade and cajole on a day-to-day basis. I needed to try and get an idea, an ethos, I keep using the word, in place, and find out who my friends were, who was attracted to it. If you want to put it in a rather colourful meaning, it was like running a banner up and seeing who was prepared to fight under that banner. And at the time, I really believed that there would be a great number of people. As it turned out, there were some very significant people. I mean, Jane Fonda became a wonderful friend. Robert Redford's been a terrific supporter, and David Seltzer, the director. There's been a dozen people, Tom Berenger, Michelle Pfeiffer, who really came through for me. But there were a lot of others who I think would have liked to, but didn't feel secure enough about their situation in life or their careers to be able to rally around quite as the way I would have hoped.
Events outside of Columbia challenged Putnam's position inside the studio. Columbia's parent company, Coca-Cola, planned to merge the studio with TriStar Pictures, a move which effectively breached their contract with Putnam. A meeting with his new boss, Victor Kaufman, failed to persuade Putnam that their plans could work within the new regime.
I understood that the way they would be running the company in the future was probably incompatible with a lot of the freedoms I had, which were pretty total. And I said I would be prepared to have those freedoms be smaller, lesser. In fact, I described it as I was prepared to work inside a smaller stockade, but with even higher walls, was the way I put it. And then the final straw, really, and no blame attached to him. He wanted to bring back somebody into a situation of some responsibility that I really thought was not just unsuitable, but completely at odds with what I was trying to do in an important part of the company. And really, when he said that, and I was sitting there, it was a very pleasant meeting, not at all acrimonious, I thought, well, we're talking about two different visions of the future, two different companies here. And I said, you know, the best thing for both of us is that I go. I go as, in an orderly way. I go in a way that that creates the least fuss, but that I go. And he said, well, I guess, he said, if that's the way you feel, and given the problems we've got, maybe you're doing the right thing. Now, it may well be that he was quietly delighted. He didn't show it, but he may well have been. I came back to the studio. Lawyers negotiated with each other for a few days as to the exact terms that I would go on, and I announced it to the staff on the Wednesday. I met him on the Friday, announced it to the staff the following Wednesday evening.
How did they take it?
Well, from my point of view, they took it rather remarkably. I mean, they were very upset. I mean, it was the most... Someone said to me afterwards, who was there, that if I go on and win another 6 Oscars, I'll never have a more touching and moving experience. And it's true, it was a rather remarkable evening. And by great good fortune, happened to be filmed, because it was at a monthly seminar we did for all the staff, which we then used to send out to all of the branches, international branches and the branches in the United States. So it's nice to have a permanent record of it.
At the end of the day, we make movies. And the movies we make are our only ambassador. So I beg you, work truly hard on the films we've finished, on the films we conceived, on the filmmakers we've worked with, on the filmmakers who are going to rely on you to carry on. And you'll be doing me the greatest favour you could possibly do me. I've had the most wonderful year. A year I could never have believed it. 3 months ago, or 3 or 4 months ago, I was wondering really if I'd ever made the right decision. But in the last few months, it's got fabulous. And Patsy and I will take home a bunch of memories I'll never, ever, ever be able to forget or thank you enough for. And thanks a lot for hearing me out.
Do you think that the films that you want to, the sort of films you want to make, the sort of system you want to establish for the making of a lot of films in this way, do you think it, after your experience, do you think it can exist here in this town?
I have to believe it can. Equally, it's true to say that in the present environment, present creative environment, it's not going to happen without significant change occurring. And the change will only be brought about by people. Now, this is a society where debate is hard to come by. It's very resistant to debate. It's a consensus-obsessed society. There will be good movies coming out of Hollywood, but I think that'll take a lot longer than it should, because there isn't the atmosphere in which debate and change occur very readily.
What do you think's left of your reforms at Columbia?
In essence, I think exactly nothing. They went back to, they chose a management team, and they've gone back to exactly the corporate style that was one of the options I put to them in the first place, which is the old baronial style, and in some respects even the old barons. So it's hard to see anything that I put in place other than, you know, we did get 18 movies going. Some of them I think are going to be terrific. This year we won more, Columbia won more Academy Award nominations than any other studio. We had 16, I think the nearest other studio was 9. Next year I can see the same thing being repeated. I mean, there are films coming, Punchline, that I'm very proud of, The Old Gringo, Jane Fonda, and directed by Luis Puenza, I think is going to be quite wonderful. The second David Mamet film, which I liked working with him enormously, the film called The Beast. I think there's a half a dozen first-class movies going to emerge from the period I was at the studio. So I can well see my best moment might well be the Academy Awards of 1989.
In 1988, Columbia's films did exceptionally well at the Academy Awards. The Last Emperor alone won 9 Oscars, including those for Best Director and Best Film, and even a short made for Columbia's new Minorities Unit picked up an award.
But is there a sense in which you are leaving? Do you feel in any sense that you're quitting the movie capital of the world?
No. If I did think that, I think I'd have a long, severe pause. But you see, it's an interesting cycle I've been through. In 1969-70, when I first came here, I did very much feel that I was arriving in the movie capital of the world, and one was very aware that we were leaving a small cottage industry and coming here. I don't sense that at all anymore. I think the opportunities that exist in Europe are enormous, and strange enough, more exciting and more vigorous than any change that I can see happening here in the next 5 to 10 years. Now, that could be pre or post-rationalization for what I've already decided to do. But I sincerely feel that. I think that the work that'll come out of Europe the opportunities in Europe, the talent that's available in Europe. It's just a more vigorous creative environment.
It's time once again to step into the future.
Hello, good evening. Tonight, we take a look at the road ahead to see what the motorist of tomorrow will be driving.
A car that will think for itself.
It will have a brain that will tune the engine hundreds of times a second. There'll be a choice of not one, but three gearbox modes at the touch of a button. Even the windows will actually feel and close themselves. But such advanced technology won't be available to you, the average motorist, until around the year 2000.
The new Cavalier from Vauxhall. The future now.
The French have won the...
Not so, not so. Gentlemen, I bring you a cannon that will blow up practically anything. The cannon color laser copier will tackle slides, photographs, it reduces and enlarges.
But what of our frontline generals, Fairfax and Halifax?
The cannon fax. It'll transmit to our field force in a jiffy.
Below, below, the French is routing it.
Gentlemen, the very latest in desktop publishing. More good news from Canon.
If anyone can, Canon can.
Hello, I'm General Accident, and this is the tax man.
Hello.
Now, in plain English, we have a plan.
We have.
With RGA personal pension and paying the basic rate of tax, for every 75p you put in...
I put in 25p.
So, with the new government incentives, the sooner you start, the better. Right?
Right.
Call your financial advisor or dial 0800-400-454 for details.
This is too good to miss. Can I borrow your phone?
Save today, secure tomorrow with a General Accident personal pension.
Savings? Sure, but not for 8 or 9%. Do I hear a start of a 10?
Make a beeline for N&P.
Last summer, David Puttnam returned to England and his house in Wiltshire to revitalise his company Enigma Films, and once again, to make England the production base for his ambitions.
It has an enormous amount to do with your mental attitude and probably your output as well.
Now that you're back in England and back in business and regrouping, how have you gone about it? I mean, what's your setup?
Well, what I tried to do is pull together the elements that I had working with me at Columbia, both the people who came with me and one or two of the people that I brought together during the time I was there, and have set out to create a fund for us, specifically for us, as it were, not something like an on-demand fund, of $50 million, a revolving fund, to make films, Enigma films, films produced by me, essentially, without having the hassle of each time you want to make a movie, going out and needing to raise the money for that movie. So this is a sum of money that's been put up for a group of films over the next 4 years.
Where do you get that sort of money from? On the one hand, it is a lot of money, $50 million. Yeah. On the other hand, given the budgets of some films these days, it could be consumed in two movies. So first of all, where do you get that sort of money from? And secondly, how far do you think you could make it go?
Well, I got it deliberately. I wanted to spread it. I didn't want it to come from any one source. Half of it comes to the United States. There's a significant investor from Japan and two European investors. And it should go a fair way. I mean, that should be enough. It's a revolving fund, so the money we make comes back in. It should be enough to fund, initial money will fund four films, because I don't want to compete at the, as it were, the Channel 4 movie in that area. I don't think there's any point. Those films are very well made. It's an area that's working. And if there's a gap in this country, it's a gap in the, if you like, the $7 to $15 million film bracket. So I've got enough money really to make about four movies. But by the time film number four is getting around to being made, film number one and maybe even number two will be out and earning money. So that should be enough to keep us going.
You danced through a bit of shorthand a few sentences ago. I'd like to take you back to you. You said you'd only make Channel 4 films because they're very well made and they occupy that. The part of the market that you don't see being well occupied here is the $7.5 to $15 million part of the market. Now, that's a shorthand that needs some explanation for people watching. So could you just expand on that and say in more detail what you mean, first about why you don't want to go the Channel 4 route, Channel 4 film, and what the sort of films, what scope the sort of films $7.5 to $15 million will have?
Well, let's deal with this Channel 4 thing for a start. I admire the films that were made for Channel 4. I made some as a producer myself before I went to America. But they are limited. They are limited in terms of the ambition that you can address. I see myself, rightly or wrongly, as an international film producer. And the type of subject matter that interests me is a subject matter that should appeal across the board to in depth in other countries. And I really want to be able to deal in metaphor. I want to deal in at a scale that allows those films to be successful in other countries. Britain's been starved of capital for that more ambitious level of production. And don't forget, with $15 million working from this country, we can make a film which is a big budget film for the Americans, that's to say, ostensibly a $25 million American picture. So as I see it, it just gives rein to a far greater breadth of ambition. It allows the directors, writers, actors, actresses, if you like, who've been groomed and weaned on the smaller films to expand their own horizons. And I think that's an important and worthwhile role for me at this point in my life.
How would you distinguish these films, let's say $15 million films for sake of argument, from the American $25 million film? Are you, as it were, merely transferring Hollywood to Wiltshire? Or are you actually saying, no, over here we can do films in big budget, but they're a different sort of film?
I think there's a type of film which is being made rarely in America, which is the, I don't know what you want to call it, the large-scale, metaphorical, ethical film about the way the world is, the way the world could be. Something less than, if you like, a straightforward action-adventure story, but also more than a straightforward action-adventure story. There's a niche I hope I've carved out for myself. I certainly feel I have, and that's the niche I want to pursue fairly relentlessly.
I know you're very loyal indeed to your friends in this country and to the industry in this country, and you've spoken for it for many years. But we are always being told there's a great pool of creative talent here. There are enormous resources compared with other countries, even compared with America. And yet the film industry hasn't fired. We haven't got the film industry. The culture that we have demands or says points us to having. Why is that? If there is this great pool, A, is it really there, or do we only like to think it's there? And if it is there, why hasn't it done more?
I had a conversation with the films minister recently, and he actually, in many ways, asked the same question. His sense was, there's a poverty of ambition. Well, yes, in a way, there is a poverty of ambition, but I think it's the poverty of ambition that comes from people who've continually been disappointed, continually felt let down, continually had ideas and had promises made to them which have proved not to be saleable or not to be doable. And sooner or later, any sensible creator starts to work within a framework that is achievable and stops trying to bang his head and bang his head and bang his head against brick walls. I guess it's for the people like me, the likes of me as a producer. My job is to bang my head against not so much brick walls but doors until those doors open.
On the other hand, one argument against that could be that, well, they've been working extremely successfully in television, either in films on four, as we've been talking about, or screen on two on BBC or ITV's dramas and so on, and doing very good work at a high level of quality and fulfilling and reach a lot of people and so on. And as it were, at its crudest, what's wrong with that?
Well, I think it's fulfilling if you decide that your idea of travelling is to go from Basildon to Edinburgh. But if you actually want to travel with your film, if you want to see the way that film impacts in Paris and Lyon and Nice, if you want to see how that film does in Geneva or in German Switzerland as it goes to French Switzerland, if you travel into France, Italy, Germany, Spain with your film, you're very quickly going to be disappointed because you're going to find that it plays at one cinema, if you're lucky, it plays at one cinema in downtown Barcelona and doesn't actually become a subject of conversation within any area of Spanish cultural life. You haven't impacted Spanish cultural life. And any filmmaker, sooner or later, because he travels to festivals, because he travels maybe eventually with a film, suddenly, I think, gets that kind of overwhelming charge that I want to be. I want to make a statement. I want my work to be seen generally throughout the world. This is the big difference between making films and making television.
You've had a good chance to have something approaching an objective look at your own country, having been so absorbed in and involved in Hollywood by the time when you're running Columbia. I know you've been there before, I know you've gone all around the world, but it's a different thing to dig in the way you did and attack the heartland of American culture the way you did. So coming back here, you must have had the advantage of the fresh look at it. I mean, do you think that the values, the cultural values, the cultural identity of this country is very strong, or do you think it's being threatened? Do you think it's being eroded? What's your view of it?
I think it's strong. I mean, when you come back, you get a very pleasant surprise into the, for example, the plurality of output in television. You know, I think one forgets that we still do make documentaries. Not many other countries make documentaries at all. The documentary form is almost non-existent in the United States, for example. We make documentaries. We deal in relative long-form news. So you can get news broadcasts which actually deal in a subject for up to 20 minutes in case of Newsnight. We do still do plays, good plays for television. So I think the breadth is encouraging. We have our share of soaps and we have our share of game shows, but they don't dominate. Now, most other places in the world, most particularly the United States, they do dominate. Soap operas and game shows absolutely dominate. And those other items which I mentioned, which are now part of our mix, become pearls among the, really, really pearls among the swine. They are quite special. And so I do think there's a danger that we're on the trailing edge, if you like, of good television. And it doesn't need much of a nudge or a push to turn it into what I would term bad television, what other people would call market force television. I do worry. It worries me a great deal. And the nature of the debate I've come back to, and its stridency, and the seeming desire for change at all costs, is worrying. Now, this is something I've changed my position on a fair bit in the last 5 years.
You're talking about the debate that's going on
specifically
about
in television.
Future, short and long-term future of television,
yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I was an early...
You see, before we go on, because obviously it's a debate that interests me a lot, you've talked almost exclusively in terms of television. I mean, you see it as that important, as a sort of brand leader and centre of the sort of cultural face of the place.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I mean, I do think that all attitudes to cinema, much as I rejoice in cinema and love cinema, and as important as I believe cinema is, I do think that cinema, if you like, is the subsidiary medium. Cinema is the thing that you go to in your spare time. Television is something which is with us every day and which, without doubt, is the medium which forges and forms our attitudes. Cinema reinforces attitudes. Cinema, I think, can be a wonderful stimulator of a debate in a particular direction or a particular area. But it isn't the fundamental thing that, that television is. Television is far more important in a sociological context. So what I've come back to is worrying. And I, as I was saying, I'm an early deregulator. I was one of the first people banging away saying, why can't I and other producers like me make films for television? And I still believe that the decision to open television up to independent production was a very, very healthy one. I don't see why that had to come, as it were, that breakthrough, an important breakthrough, had to come hand in glove with the idea that everything in Britain to do with television was wrong and the whole thing needed a kind of thorough scouring. Many of the attitudes were old-fashioned. Many of the practices were wrong, no question. But I'm worried at the sort of vehemence of the move to change things. And I'm also actually quite worried about the relative poverty of the debate, quality of the debate. It's been very poor, I think poorly informed, and there doesn't seem to me to have been a great deal of breadth of thinking and an extraordinary cavalier attitude toward preserving the best of what we have, because the best of what we have is well worth preserving. It's quite extraordinary.
It's quite hard to defend the status quo. I mean, that's one of the things that's been difficult. And people also feel that the arguments about public service broadcasting have been uttered so often that the very people who are in best position to utter them actually feel tired of hearing themselves speak.
The truth of the matter is maybe one does have to devise new words to substitute for public service. But the truth of the matter is, what is public service? Public service is a common denominator, a notion which we all share, of the things which will benefit this country in the long term. and not necessarily merely the expedients which will benefit somebody within this country or some small group of people in this country in the short term. That seems to me the definition of public service.
What seems to have happened is that in this country, for 50 or 60 years, television, growing out of radio, was regarded as a cultural force. Now then, pious as that may sound, pretentious as that may sound, that was what it was regarded as. That's how it saw itself, and that's how the British people saw it. They saw it as the place where they talked to each other, about each other, in the documentaries, in EastEnders, in Coronation Street, in the plays, whatever. It is now seen as a place to make money. Now, why do you think that's happened? Do you see it as being something that is reversible, or what?
This notion of this lobby, the so-called lobby for deregulation, who is this lobby and what is this lobby? As I see it, it's made up of, as you say, of advertisers, of businessmen, of people who intend to make money out of the medium, just money out of the medium. People who don't see themselves as being part of the cultural mix or the social mix of the country. People who certainly don't see themselves as having fundamental responsibility for this medium and therefore through the medium to the ordinary man and woman in the street in this country. They are the lobby. And the idea that they're being allowed to have the only voice, and to an extent they are the only voice, is a... I don't know, it's hopelessly undemocratic, and I think very dangerous. And I think it's about time the debate was broadened, and as you say, the audience, the consumer, got a voice.
In your deep background, there's an advertising stage, and you've kept up with that world. You work in a world which is ferociously commercial. I work in a world which is protectedly commercial, in commercial television, or so far protectedly commercial. Do you have any feelings of ambiguity about worrying about the sort of commercial nose leading? Do you feel, well, that was actually what I wanted to happen and where in a world in which I thrive, and perhaps why am I protecting this thing called television where I would accept that the commercial nose leads in films?
But as you say, I come out of advertising, and therefore I feel better qualified to talk about advertising than most people. And I put this theory to you, and I think this deserves a lot of thought. At the moment, dealing in a situation where government, police, and the ordinary man on the street are kind of bewildered about the state of society. We haven't yet broken down into a completely nihilistic society, but we've certainly got a lot of problems. You've got this business of so-called middle-class crime. You've got this business of people ripping off, not so much because they need anything or need the money, but almost as a way of life. It's almost as a macho challenge. Now, where's it come from? I came from a very interesting generation of young ad men. We all read the same books. There were Vance Packard's book, The Hidden Persuaders, Rossa Reeves' book, Truth in Advertising. And we learned our lessons well. We were all at night school together. Charles Saatchi, Frank Lowe, David Abbott, all the people who now run the advertising industry and control the really big agencies, not just in this country, but worldwide. We learned our lessons very well. We're responsible in this country for better quality advertising than anywhere else in the world for the last 25 years. Really superb advertising. If you go back 25 years, you'll remember that there was a thing called product advertising. You literally showed a picture of your product, put the price on it, and offered it on sale to the public. We were taught to do things very differently. We were taught to try and make the consumer feel inadequate, to make the consumer feel that if he didn't buy our product, somehow or other he wasn't enjoying the full fruits of life, or somehow or another he was not keeping up with the Joneses. I mean, that was the classic thing that we were geared to do. So we were trained to create a sense of inadequacy in the consumer. 25 years later, having done that quite wonderfully, maybe the net result has been a kind of sublimated anger, a real anger, maybe for 25 years, dangling a series of expectations in front of the audience that most of them, some of them, maybe all, maybe most of them, know that in their lifetimes it's not going to be affordable or achievable, has maybe created some sense of malaise, some sense of irritation, anger, which is exploding in the type of society and fragmentation of society that genuinely bewilders Mrs. Thatcher and her advisors.
So that actually throws a responsibility, as you put it now, onto advertisers to find a way of doing the job, which is to call attention to the availability of these goods without bringing on false expectations.
And maybe what we're suggesting, I mean, I hadn't thought of this before at all, but maybe what we're saying here is that instead of polarizing the argument between the deregulation of the broadcasting lobby, i.e. the businessmen, and ourselves, the public service lobby, the instinctive saluters to the notion of public service, maybe the problem is really we've got to get the businessman, the advertiser, to climb in the bath with us, to let him see that implicit in selling his product and implicit in making a profit, there is a social responsibility. He knows there's a social responsibility in terms of employment, if he's localised or regionalised, Maybe now what he's got to understand is there is a broader social responsibility in terms of the way in which he's selling his product, the quality of his product, the nature of his product. And maybe once and for all in this country, we've got to climb into the same bath and realise that if the price of an advertiser getting a lower cost per thousand for his ad is the end of documentaries as we know them in Britain, the end of serious news analysis as we know it in Britain, the end of the play for today or the wonderful piece of one-off drama as we know it in Britain, then that's too high a price to pay. And at the end of the day, for that advertiser, it'd be a completely Pyrrhic victory, because all he's going to be sticking is a second-rate product advertised in a second-rate manner into a slot in between two segments of a second-rate programme. I don't believe that's what they want.
Nor do I, but how do you persuade them when actually what they're concerned with is actually going back to their bosses next year and saying, now we've got the fifth channel or the 10 channels on satellite, so we can bring you a cheaper deal, which we'll obtain for a year or two.
Truth of the matter is, you actually can change an ethos. Mrs. Thatcher proved that in 1969, in economic terms. So maybe what we need to do is the kind of sea change that was created between 79 and 83. Maybe in those days we were talking about macroeconomics versus microeconomics. Maybe now we've got to start talking about macro-social responsibility as opposed to micro-social responsibility, and unhook these guys who I'm sure would like their knighthoods and their peerages and one thing or another from this obsession, as I say, with short-term profit improvements to how do you judge a company? Are there other ways of judging it within a social context? And they can be lured into the bath, I use this expression all the time, deliberately, if it seemed to be in their interest. And what we've got to do is make it in their interest, maybe by holding up the spectre of the road down which at the moment we're travelling, which you and I both see as desperately unattractive. I just don't think that spectre's been held up. But the other thing, instead, it hasn't really been articulated, is because there's been, this poverty of debate, is I think that the ordinary man or woman in the street, the viewer on television, hasn't had a chance to put up their hand and vote for what they do like about television at present.
Coming back to your own role as a film producer, how do you relate what's happening in this country to what you saw very much from the inside of not only the film industry, but one of the heartlands of American industry in Hollywood?
My experience of being in Columbia was disappointing in many ways, not least by coming face-to-face with the, I felt, extremely limited cultural choices, creative choices, that are allowed to a senior executive within any media, any serious American media corporation. And I've used the word media, not film, because I think the choices are even more limited if you're the president of CBS or NBC or ABC, one of the networks. But I see this great narrowing of choice in the United States, which is very odd because it comes at the same time as the broadening of delivery mechanisms. As more satellites come in, as more cable comes in, as more means and channels of getting this information out to the public, only seems to be followed by a limiting and a greater and greater and greater limiting of the spectrum of choice when it comes down to the nature of the programs. That is a real paradox.
Yes, and that threatens to a certain extent here.
I think so, totally. And I think anyone that doesn't see that, as I say, is choosing not to see it. Now, I would suggest there are only two significant things worth protecting, preserving, really significant. One is democracy, as we know it in this country, and the best way of securing that is to make absolutely sure there's a genuinely independent BBC, genuinely independent ITV, in fact, a genuinely independent broadcasting sector, which offers a maximum plurality of programming, maximum plurality of political view, maximum plurality of opinion. That isn't going to be achieved by a cost per thousand obsessed or an advertising ratings obsessed television industry. That's one. The second thing is, if we're going to leave behind as a generation, yours and my generation, anything better than what we found, then that's going to depend entirely on the cultural output. And our cultural output, in turn, will depend on the opportunities we have to make good television programming at an affordable cost and not be constricted in the way that I've described the American system, not be constricted by this ridiculous limitation of choice, again being pressed in on both sides by the commercial considerations, again the cost per thousand, again the profit at the end of the day. So I do believe there is a genuine confluence between what you and I want to do in terms of programming, between what offers the best opportunity for plural political and every other kind of thought through broadcasting in this country, and the ultimate ambitions of the businessmen who you're just referring to. Because their ultimate ambitions, presumably, are to affect society, not merely just to make more and more money for their company. That must be a means to an end. The end in itself, and this has been shown over and over and over again, as these men become multimillionaires, as they gain their peerages, they wish to leave their mark on history. Their mark on history is not left by the size of their company. Their mark on history tends to be left by the social role they play in the last years of their lives. So I think there is a natural confluence.
Thanks very much.